I don't see the PowerPoint, however, so I don't know if I should close out
I
of
got
some.
it. Yeah.
Okay.
All right,
And
well,
you want
welcome everyone. It's 11 o'clock, so we're going to get started. We are going to be talking about the public library and the importance of summer food service and fighting childhood hunger. And we have Cathy here with us today, and she's the manager of the summer food service program for Kentucky. So we're very excited to hear all about this. Thanks, Cathy.
Thank you so much, Kim. And I'm really excited to be here. I appreciate y'all so much. And we have enjoyed a wonderful working relationship with the public libraries in Kentucky and the Summer Food Service Program for years. So we really appreciate you. I was telling one of my coworkers here, I said, I'm going to go speak to the librarians from public libraries in Kentucky. And I said, they are a sharp bunch because you are. And she said, I know they're book smart, and I thought that was pretty good, but I know you're smart in other ways too. So great to have you here, and I'm happy to speak to you about the Summer Food Service Program. You are definitely an important partner in fighting childhood hunger in our state. So let's get started. So this is a quote that I like, and I always like to talk about a little bit when we talk about this program and childhood hunger and what we see in Kentucky. So this is from Carl Sagan. He said, this is from several years ago, but research shows that many children who do not have enough to eat wind up with diminished capacity to understand and learn. Children don't have to be starving for this to happen. Even mild undernutrition, the kind most common among poor people in America, can do it. So I just think that's good to keep in mind, because sometimes when we think about food insecurity and poverty and hunger, we kind of think about the obvious. And I think sometimes it's important to remember the most common type of poverty may not look like poverty to many. It could impact the nutrition a child receives. However, even a mild level of a struggle with income for a family. And children who struggle with mild undernutrition might do this summer after summer when they are not receiving school meals. So if we look at a four-year period and we think about the time that they're out of school in the summer over a four-year period, a math's pretty easy to do, that's about 25% of their lives over just that example, four-year period, where they could be getting poor nutrition. That ultimately will affect their ability to be healthy and to grow and develop like they need to. So I guess I could say that hunger has many faces. Libraries have a unique opportunity to nourish both mind and body through the summer meals program. And somehow I've missed a slide in here. I probably will have to go back at the end and find it. But we have a non-discrimination statement I'm always supposed to share. Basically, we feed all kids, but we have the official non-discrimination statement that I think I skipped over. But, you know, you all are such an important hub in the community. You know that. I'm not telling you anything you don't know. But because you're open to all and you are a trusted environment, it's a very welcoming place to children and teens and families. You're providing great enrichment programming. There's just a whole lot that's important for children that they would get at a library. And I think it's important to think about the fact that you are a trusted environment. Several years ago, some research was done by, I don't remember exactly, it could have been the FRAC group. It was a national group that's associated with hunger and even with child nutrition programs. And they engaged parents to determine where they felt good about their children going to get a summer meal, because sometimes the children are going unaccompanied. So, you know, what appealed to parents? And kids going to a trusted environment ranked very high in priority. And of course, the library, the public library, is always a trusted environment. So I think that's really important to remember. I'm not talking to you like y'all are a pool or a park, which is those are great places, but not necessarily as supervised. So very, very important to be involved with the public library. And kids and teens need healthy meals to learn, whether it's a day they're out of school or during the school year. A lot of kids just don't go day to day with the nutrition that they need. So what is the Summer Food Service Program in a nutshell? It is a federal program that provides free healthy summer meals to children and teens at eligible sites. And we'll talk about what some of this means. Children and teens means basically it's for kids 18 and under, unless they are still enrolled in school and they may have a physical or mental disability, which in Kentucky would mean up to 21 for those kids. So I'm going to use the term site and sponsor, and it's kind of a parent-child arrangement where the sponsors for the parent, the sites are the children, and the sponsor is an organization. It could be a public or private nonprofit school food authority. It could be a college or university. It could be a government unit, or it could be any type of private nonprofit organization. The sponsor is the local entity that is responsible for getting food to the children through the sites. So the sponsor oversees the sites. They look for sites. They recruit places to provide meals for kids. They train and supervise the site staff. They provide meals to the sites. They monitor those sites, and then they attend our training. They do a lot of paperwork with us, and then part of that is submitting their meal count numbers so they can get a claim to be reimbursed for those meals. Just a side note, most, but not all, of Kentucky school districts are Summer Food Service Program sponsors. So again, just thinking about what a site is, it's basically a location where Summer Food Service meals are served. They need to be in areas where there's a demonstrated need. And by that, I mean they serve families in areas where there's demonstrated low income. It could be, we'll talk about this in a minute, it could be the school free reduced percentage, it could be census data, but it has to be an area that has documented low income families. Open sites, however, are open to all children and teens. There's no signups or financial checks. So if you are an open site in an area that is demonstrated as having a need because of low income population, any child shows up. The individual child and family do not have to qualify to come get a meal. They just have to be safe places where children gather. We'll talk a little bit more about that. However, I will say in 2023, there were changes to the Summer Food Service Program brought about by the omnibus bill at the end of last year. It's a huge bill, and believe it or not, there were about two paragraphs in that, I think, 4,000 page bill dedicated to the Summer Food Service Program where Congress and passed and then the president signed into law non-congregate meals in rural areas. I'm not going to talk a lot about that, but I'd be certainly very happy at the end to answer any questions. Basically, that means areas that are determined to be rural can provide meals in a non-congregate setting, meaning kids can come get a meal, grab and go, and leave. They don't have to eat on site. In the past, and still, in areas that are not rural, there is a congregate requirement, meaning the kids eat in a supervised setting. So you could be one or the other. If you were a site, you could be a grab-and-go location, which really doesn't give the kids access to your great programming, or you could be a congregate setting where the kids stay and eat and get to take advantage of the great things you offer them. So just a few slides that I was provided about food insecurity in Kentucky, and these are from Feeding Kentucky. This first is just a visual. It's a little bit hard to see, but basically I like visual things. I'm a visual learner, and when I look at this, I see the majority of the state is a one particular gradient of this green, olive green color that represents between about 11% and 20%. Almost 24% food insecurity. And then so those darker areas are even a higher food insecurity rate, and the more pale areas are less food insecurity. Probably something you would know intuitively, but I think sometimes it's interesting to look at when it's mapped out. And then this is just another way to summarize just in 2021 what was found as far as food insecurity in Kentucky. And, you know, there's data on here about the number of children, the average cost of meal at that time. It's probably a bit higher now. And the pie graph there with the number of children under 18 years that are the rate for the entire state of food insecurity. But I think what's on the right kind of goes back to that Carl Sagan slide that I shared, because out of that number of children, that pie, that slice of pie, that 15.2%, 73% of that group is eligible for federal child nutrition programs, but 27% are ineligible due to income. So this is very likely that group of children that are food insecure, even though they don't appear to be impoverished. It's that kind of borderline. So it just kind of gives you another way of looking at that. I guess it's one of those things we don't always know, right? That a child might be hungry. So just a few benefits about the being a site, benefits to the library. But I think what's really important to think about is the fact that these children might be in your library. And I just want you to think about this. When was the last time you tried to read a book and connect with what you were reading when you were really hungry, really hungry? I honestly cannot tell you the last time. I think if I was hungry, I'd go get something to eat. I think most of us would. So it's something just to kind of keep in mind. Maybe food would really supplement what you're doing there for those children. Feeding these hungry kids would be important. It might even attract new patrons to your library and your programs. It definitely is going to bring you up in visibility as a strong community partner, that you're out there to serve kids, even if it means giving them a meal. And of course, you can develop new relationships with your local schools, with childcare. How wonderful to get a childcare involved, maybe in a program you have, and because you have meals there, you're offering them meals, and that might result in a continuing relationship. And if you're already providing snacks or meals, this could save you money because you could get your meals or snacks for free. And everybody knows what it's like to be hangry. It could even possibly decrease behavioral issues because you're getting a little food in those empty tummies and hopefully conquering the hangry monster that might be there. So if you were interested in being a site, what do you need to do? And just a word here, not all these pictures, but many of these pictures are from Kentucky sites. This particular one is from Webster County. It's not in a library, but I just love these pictures. So just wanted to share. Some of these are Kentucky kids you're going to see in the pictures we're sharing. So you do need someone to serve the meals and supervise. Most sponsors, if you're a site under a sponsor in your local area, they're going to ask you to man the site. They don't always have people they can send out to provide the meals. Some do. Chances are they're going to want you to provide somebody. Could be your staff. You could involve volunteers. You need a place for them to eat. It could be inside or outside. You want to have something to clean up if you have spills, and then just trash cans, because most of these food meals are going to come in little clamshell packages or some kind of packaging you'll need to dispose of. You need a sponsor. Maybe, maybe not. We'll talk about that in a minute. But if you're going to be a site under a sponsor, you need to have somebody that's going to provide you the meals and be responsible for all the administrative aspects of the program. And we'll talk about what that is. Of course, you're offering enrichment. You're offering what you do great with kids. I don't need to tell you this, but that's really going to keep kids involved, and you're going to be feeding their minds as well as their tummies. For our program, for the summer program, activities are not required. So if you were someplace that just wanted to hand out meals and not do activities, it's perfectly fine with our program. If you wanted to do the at-risk after-school program, which I'm not going to speak about today, you would be required to have activities. And I would say hang in there, because it sometimes is a little bit of work to get started and to get comfortable with what you're doing, but hang in there. With an open mind and a good attitude, it'll all come around and work out great for you. I may even have some people on this that are already sites, so you all might even want to share some of your experiences when we get done here. Here's another one of the pictures from Webster County. Darling little girl. So you have a lot of opportunities, a lot of options for meals. It could be maybe you want to receive lunch Monday through Friday all summer, or on certain days of the week, or maybe you want to get supper for a special event, or maybe you just want to do snack. You can do any combination of two meals, which would include a snack, except lunch and supper. So you could do breakfast and lunch, or lunch and snack, or you know, you kind of get the picture, but there's a lot of possible combinations that you could do. One disclaimer I'll give with that, though, is your sponsor would need to be able to provide that meal. So not all of our sponsors provide a supper meal, I will say that, but they might be able to work with you to provide maybe a easily refrigerated meal, a sandwich, and the things that would go with that. So just thinking about supper is not our most popular meal, but if you decided to do it, it might take a understanding with your sponsor that you need that. So one thing you may want to think about, if you want to be a site, what other sites exist in your area? This is not nearly as complicated as it looks here, but there is a really good mapping tool that USDA provides that you could use to determine where are there sites in your area. So this might be really helpful for you if you aren't going to serve, but you wanted to be aware of where there are other locations in the area and who are the sponsors serving those sites. So if you want to walk through this later, we won't do it now. You can try this little mapping tool. It's really pretty amazing. So you can see in there, you could either back out and look at a big overview and see all the sites in your area and get really an idea of what's going on in your area. And we talked about eligibility. So this is also another very involved slide. And if you like, it would be fun for you to play with it. But I will just tell you, if in doubt, you could always contact your local sponsor. And the first place to start is the local school district, the food service director or nutrition director, and just see, if they're involved and are they providing meals. And they can tell you if your location is in an attendance area of a school where there's at least 50% of the population eligible for free or reduced meals. I can tell you then in Kentucky, as you know, there are 120 counties, and every year we look at all the data. We look at all that free reduced data for all the schools, for every school in every district in the state. And we are able to predetermine that there are many, many counties where it's eligible in the entire county area. In fact, for 2023, it was 110 out of 120 counties that at any location a site could be placed. Because of the, as you know, just a high need in our state, we tend to struggle with poverty in our state. So it's really, this is fun if you want to do it, but I would say if you're not sure, contact us. I mean, if out of those 120 counties, the 10 that are not eligible anywhere in the county, you could probably sit here and figure it out. Fayette, Jefferson, Oldham, Northern Kentucky, several counties. But if you aren't certain and you're in an area that might not be eligible, you could either check this or just contact us and we'll help you determine if you're in an eligible area. Easy peasy. All right, so say you want to jump in and be a site. How do you know what to do? I mentioned earlier, you can contact your local child nutrition or food service director in the district where you're located. They'll let you know right away if they're serving or not. Many do, but not all. Contact us. If you aren't able to find a sponsor that way, contact us. We have a few nonprofit organizations that cover many counties. And if possible, we could see if we could arrange for somebody to provide meals and oversight for you through a nonprofit organization. Or you could become a sponsor like Lawrence County Public Library. I don't know if Dean is on here, but Dean Ferris is, her library, Lawrence County Public Library, is a summer food service program sponsor. And this is a picture from her program. I think it's probably from a couple of years ago, but I just love this picture. You see kids having a great time doing some crafts, it looks like, and it's also just a great room for them to use for the meals. So that's always a possibility, and we'd be glad to talk to you about what's involved with that. In fact, if you wanted to be a sponsor, some of the advantages are you could go beyond your library and serve sites in the community to reach more children. That's something that the Lawrence County Public Library has done too. You receive reimbursement for your meals. We work with you to let you know what the reimbursement is. In most cases, it's close. It's not a profit-making proposition at all. It's basically the idea is that you cover the cost of your meals. So we could certainly work with you on what you need to think about for you know what the reimbursement is, and then what you would need to do to arrange for meals. But I'll talk about that in a minute. So another possible advantage is there are grant opportunities from organizations that work with our program, and you might possibly be eligible for some grant funds that would support your meal program and support your library as well. So if that's something that interests you, contact me or one of my staff. We'll let you know what you need to do. Of course, there's forms. There's forms to fill out. And there's some initial steps we would need to take. And then we provide a training for you all. It's about pretty much a full day training. We do those in person because we think that's very valuable. Our new sponsor training is in Frankfurt. Arranging for meals. This is because we're a federal program, this is where you would try to get people to give you some pricing on meals. It could be a mom and pop restaurant. It could be a variety of possibilities. You could arrange with another sponsor or a school district, or you could put the opportunity out to bid. You need to ask at least three different potential bidders. If it's a school, you don't have to go through this. But if you're just, say, wanting to contact local small restaurants to see if they could provide these meals, you need to at least ask three, and then you choose the one that gives you the best possible combination of price and service. You would train your staff. You oversee your program. You provide the meals, and you count the meals. We'll talk about that. And then you submit the claim for reimbursement. So just keep that in the back of your mind. That's always a possibility, and we'd welcome you to be one of our sponsors. I will say this, there may be some people on this presentation or in this presentation that have a public library in an area where we do not have anybody serving meals. And if that was the case, we would hold your hand and help you come on board to get started with this, because we would love to have you as a meal hub and a gathering place for children in your community. And I can tell you off the top of my head, Caldwell County, I don't know if we have anybody on here from Caldwell County. We'd love to get somebody set up there. We have a few other counties in Western Kentucky that are unserved. And we have a few other counties that are underserved, meaning the local school district may be providing some meals. But we have several districts that they'll provide maybe 2 or 3 weeks worth of meals in June while they're doing enrichment programs in their schools, and they're just providing them in the schools. So we'd like to expand the meal offering to all children in the community for as much of the summer as possible. So if you find there's nobody serving, please get in touch. We'd love to work with you to improve that. All right. So here's what you don't need. If you're a site, you don't need to buy or prepare food. You really won't have much paperwork to complete. We're going to talk about that in a minute. You don't need a lot of storage space. Most of the time, sponsors deliver the meals, but occasionally we have sponsors who don't have the staff to deliver. So you may be going and picking up meals, but our sponsors typically provide those meals in coolers or temperature-controlled holding coolers or Cambros, that sort of thing, usually coolers. And they will provide that so that you don't have to have big refrigerators or and sometimes you even have shelf stable meals. So it's really simple, and you don't have to have a kitchen to prepare meals. You do not need to register meals or children for the meal program. You can serve any kid or any teen that would like a meal. They don't even have to be part of your program. Maybe you have a program and kids just show up. You can certainly feed them whether they stay for your program or not. That would be your decision, but that's fine to do that. So if you are just a site, this is pretty much the total of your paperwork for a site. This is just a little snip of part of each of these, but we have a daily meal count form. The sponsor provides this, and basically you just mark the meals off as they're served. And then a site record of meals served. The daily meal count form is done each time you serve meals, and these go to the sponsor at least once a week. The site record of meal served just stays on site, and that just keeps a running record of what you have served. And this is primarily because there may be a reviewer that will come around and do a review of your site, and they would need to say, okay, let me see your record, and they can look back and see the meals record of meals served. Now, I will give you, I'm just going to give you a little, tip, and it might make you very powerful. So if you are a site or you plan to be a site, these daily meal count forms, I think, are a little, you know, kind of a old school way of doing things. And we actually make available to all sponsors in Kentucky at no cost an electronic meal counting option where an app is downloaded to the phone of the site staff or supervisor or supervisors, and you actually just click a button on your cell phone or a tablet, smartphone or a tablet, to count the meals, and that's sent to the sponsor. So in the event you decide to do this, ask them if you can use that electronic meal count. And they may be you may be their first site to try it, because a lot of times I think our sponsors think, oh, the sites aren't going to want to do that, when it's really very easy technology to use. And I think if a site approached a sponsor and said, I'd like to try that electric meal count, it would give them an opportunity to use it and see how wonderful it is, because these two paper forms go away. So that is an option. It's called Cartwheel, but that is our electronic meal counting option that's free. So would love it if you all were interested in that. So just to give you an idea, what do the kids get to eat? This is just lunch or supper. Of course, it's going to look a little bit different if it's breakfast or a snack. But meals are, you know, it's a meal pattern that USDA requires. It involves 8 ounces of milk. It could be any flavor, any kind of milk. In our program, we don't have a lot of restrictions. We don't have fat restrictions for the milk. It could be whole milk. It could be skim milk. It could be chocolate, strawberry. It does have to be milk, though, dairy milk, unless the child has a record of a food allergy that would be and the sponsor would be responsible for dealing with an alternative. A meat or meat alternate needs to be served, grain or bread. It does not have to be whole grain. We try to get our sponsors to provide good whole grain, but it is not required. 2 different servings of fruit and vegetable, one of which could be juice, are also served. We really try to encourage our sponsors to use a lot of Kentucky grown or locally grown products. So we love it when the fruit or vegetable in particular is a locally grown, because nothing tastes better than food grown in your own backyard. So that's kind of an overview of the meal pattern that you would see if you serve lunch. So as far as what makes a great program, you know, an inviting space is what's really needed. Of course, if it's in your library, that's great. We'll talk about what if you can't do that, if that's not an option for you. If you're a sponsor and you're looking for sites to have under your program, any place really that children can get a meal will work. Grab and go. Okay, so grab and go, as I mentioned, this non-congregate option is for sponsors that have sites in rural, I don't know why that's hard to say, rural areas. And really, without getting into the weeds on that, it's basically something that if you're going to be a site, you and your sponsor can talk about that, or you can check with us and we can let you know. But in that case, if it is non-congregate, then kids could grab and go. And you don't have to do that. That's totally up to you. But they could come, take their food and leave. And all they're really coming for in that case is a meal. But you always have that option to have activities to keep them on site. And I think that's really the very best thing. So if you need to, translating the program information into whatever the family's primary language is very important for not only creating an inviting space, but really making them feel welcome and helping them to understand what the program is about. And the asterisk on these items here means that we are able to provide resources for that. So we do have material in many, many translations. Providing multiple methods to communicate the program rules. It really you're really just going to say these meals are for kids. In most cases, that's a very important rule. But we do have resources we can provide that are, you know, beautiful forms that you can, you know, print and put up that will just communicate a little bit about the program, just so families understand, and as well as table toppers and information about the program. We also have resources for that. And, you know, one of the things that is really great with this, with the summer program, is it's during summer when there's a lot of great food in season, a lot of great fruits and vegetables. And we hear all the time about kids, particularly in remote areas, that have really limited experience with a variety of foods, particularly produce. So it's a great opportunity to teach the children a little bit, get them to try new foods, and, you know, just help promote healthy eating. You know, we can never do that too much, right? Getting that message from many different sources is just going to mean that kids will understand the importance of healthy eating. So you could play a very important role in that too. So, you know, it's something to think about, is to be mindful of staffing. You know, it's it could be tough, and we get that. We encourage people to use volunteers, and I'll talk a little bit about that more in a minute. And that kind of helps with, depending on how big your program is, that might help with your staffing constraints. Think about when you want to serve. If you're a site under a sponsor, it'll really, obviously, I guess, be dependent on how long they will have meals available. But we love to see the meals start right after school's out and go until right before kids go back to school. The kids that really need these meals really need these meals when they're out of school and they're not getting those school lunches. So that's the ideal. And then if you're operating late in the summer, you might do some outreach to sustain participation through the year, but also you could also do back to school events to just support that transition back to school. So sometimes it's not possible to be a summer site, and we get that. That's you know, that's just how it is sometimes. So there are other ways to support summer feeding without being a site. One thing you can do is promote the summer meal sites. You can do outreach in a variety of ways, social media, on your website, you know, just having literature available when people, you know, at the desk, at the help desk, information about summer sites that you can share while families are in there, to help get the word out, and just talk to that local school district or any nonprofit that serves and ask them how you can help them promote their meal sites. Very, very, very important. You may be familiar with this program, but it's amazing to me. I've been doing this for many years, and it's amazing how many people still don't know about this program. So program awareness is huge. And anytime we can promote information about the program, it's helpful. It's extremely helpful. So you might play that role. Being an enrichment resource. So this is super important. You know, you might just be that adjunct to what's going on already at sites. You could be at summer meal sites that are already operating, even if you can't serve at your particular library location. Find out where meal sites are being offered. A great opportunity might be at a local apartment complex where you could go and set up, and some of you may already be doing this, but you could provide enrichment programming there at that location where the kids are already gathering for meals. You could take your bookmobile to those locations where kids are getting meals. You can register, have library card registration at summer meal sites. You can also at the summer meal sites sign up kids for your summer library program, reading program, or other programs that you're offering. And you could provide book giveaways. You can, you know, provide lots of, I know what you all do so wonderfully with enrichment, and information about your library. So there's a lot you can do, even if you're not going to serve meals right where you are. If I hit that twice. Nope, here we're good. Okay. So As far as planning, you all, this is, I know you all know all about library programs and what you do in your libraries, but it's just important to think about, don't do your programs simultaneously during food service time. Really before or after is great, maybe after so that they're not hungry, but informal activities during the meal service time are good, but it's really hard to keep the kids' attention when they're eating and talking to each other and laughing, and you know, you all know that. That's probably pretty self-explanatory. You can obviously announce your programs, your summer library program, or your opportunities during those meal and snack times. This is just some other suggestions. Again, we're going back to that whole programming thing that you all do so well. There's also a first book program that you can find by going to this USDA first books. If this, I know this hyperlink probably won't work for y'all, but you could Google this and it'll take you right to it. And then, as I mentioned before, back to school readiness program, very important. You may or may not be able to serve meals during that time. Be great if you could, but that's also very important for these kids as they get ready to go back to school. So as far as youth engagement, you know, I've been to sites, and I know, I don't know how many of you all have had teen volunteers and teen workers in your library program, but all I know is the faces of the young kids really light up when they have a teen there helping them and hanging out with them. They really, it's a win-win. It really is. So, you know, find volunteers, maybe work with the local beta club or sports clubs or, you know, youth service agencies, local universities that might have youth that would be a valuable asset to your program. It's good to have consistent role models. So, you know, I'm talking about meals here. I know you all know about volunteers for all your programs, but if they're coming in just to help serve a meal, it's just still good with kids to try to get, you know, five or more shifts out of these volunteers to have consistent, but to build those relationships and have consistencies. Faith-based organizations, local clubs, you can get volunteers from a lot of places, and you just need to make sure you have ample time for any background checks you need to do for them. If they are going to be volunteering for the meal service, if they're part of the meal service with the kids, those volunteers would need to attend a training by the local sponsor, or if you're the sponsor, you would need to train them. Part of that is civil rights. It's just a requirement with our program because it's a federal program using federal funds. And if you have a large group of volunteers, you may want to ask your sponsor to come train them all, because that would be important that they would all be trained. All right, so this question oftentimes comes up. What about those adults? What about those parents or grandparents or caregivers that bring those kids to the library for a program? And it is difficult when the child's eating and you've got a, I can remember being at a site and you had a child eating and a mama who was expecting a baby and you could tell she was hungry. That's a difficult situation. I guess, you know, if I was just going to give you a pat answer, it is a program that is for children 18 and under. However, there are a few other things to consider. You know, talk to the sponsor to see if there's any funding to pay for adult meals. If, as long as the adults have a meal paid for in some way, they may have a meal. Again, it's really the sponsor's call on this, but the sponsor may have, sometimes sponsors get organizations in the community to say, I just want to give money to the program, and they can use that to cover the cost of meals. But there are ways to do it. In general, it's not what the meals are for, but there are ways to try to work that out. A couple of other options would be you can provide, you know, information on where there are local free food programs available to adults and give that out while the kids are eating. Another option would be work with a local food pantry and see if they want to come set up occasionally, you know, at your program, a almost like a little market where parents could come get food that they could take home for the family. So there are other ways even if it doesn't mean a meal right at the site. And there's a great lunch at the library website that I don't have. I don't know if you'll be able to connect from this. I don't know if you'll have this in electronic format, but it's the California program lunch at the library, and you could Google for that. It's really good. And they've done a lot of good work with the summer food service program out there. So, if you're not sure where summer meals are happening in your area or who a sponsor is, I mentioned you could contact the local school district, but you could also use this wonderful text function. If you use it now, it's not going to tell you anything because there's nobody serving right now. But during the summertime, anybody can text the word food or comida to 304-304. And it's pretty cool because you'll get a response that will ask you to enter your location. I always say put as much detail as possible. A street number, street name in a town is the very best way to do it, because that will give you a list of the closest meal sites to that location. So just a great tool. This has been used very well in Kentucky, and have this information available for your patrons too, because I think it's just a very good resource to help. And it's national. I mean, they can use this anywhere, but you know, if you had a grandparent that brought in grandkids and they have other grandkids that live in another part of the state, they could use that anywhere and locate meal sites. So it's something that No Kid Hungry provides. It's no cost, and we update the information weekly, so it's kept current and people can find meals. So I did not go back to that slide. You all have, if you have this PowerPoint, the second slide was the USDA non-discrimination statement. So you have it if you want to go back and read it. Just very important that we serve all kids without any discrimination. So I'm happy to take any questions you might have.
You guys can put those in the chat or just unmute and talk to us, either way.
Yeah.
Unless you explained it so well.
Well, you know, my question for you all is, we have kind of a small group. Are any of you all currently, or, you know, have you been in the last few years, a meal site with the summer food service program? You could just type it in the chat, or you could unmute or raise your hand. I know we use Teams to do these types of presentation. There's a little delay, so I'm used to a delay. So you're all new to it. Since I don't know who you are, I guess you could do this. What is the likelihood? Oh, we have Estill County. Yes, Estill County Public Library. You've been on the program for a long time, I think, several years. Great. And Estill County is a high need area, and the school district does participate, but we could use as many sites as we can there. So I'm sure that your families really appreciate you there. Great, thanks. Is there anything else I could tell you or any questions I could answer if you have not participated that would help? Great. That's wonderful. Thank you, Sarah. Well, I will say this, we, my mighty staff of three and me, we love working with people. And so maybe this will just bounce around in your thoughts for a while, and you might think down the road, this is something you want to look into. I would definitely say, you know, talk to your local sponsor, build a relationship there, but please contact us. Here's my phone number. Anytime, give us a call. we are more than happy to have a conversation about how to get meals to kids in your area. And we love the libraries. We really do. Y'all do a great job. I'm in Oldham County. I don't know if anybody on here is from Oldham County. We love our libraries here in Oldham County. So we appreciate you all very much and would love to work with you. Perfect. Thank you so much for attending.
Thank you, Cathy, for being here and explaining this for us and giving us all of the good stuff that they can use.
Great. My pleasure.